I'm going to take a little side trip in this topic of integrated hypocrisy to add a dimension to it so that when you hear the rest of it, you can keep this dimension in mind. The essence of hypocrisy and the reason why we adopt it is to mask our real attitudes. Okay? We are trying to get something, and we think that by acting in a certain way, other than the way we really think, other than the way we really feel about something, if we take the opposite approach, that we will win the thing we seek. Now, there's another part to that, really, which is an inability. Okay, we'll be talking about that in future episodes, but I just want to focus on the bottom of it here. This is something we all know, but we don't think about. We're hypocritical because we're in a situation where the situation is such that we don't like the situation we're in. We feel we have to belie our attitude in order to get something we want out of a situation we don't want to be in. We can't afford to be honest. Can't. That's an inability. We can't afford to be honest. And we have to adopt some kind of manner of speaking or behavior or pretend to like the situation that we're in order to get something else out of it. In other words, we're doing something to get something. Pretty much all human behavior is based on that. You do what you do to get something. When you take a shower, you're doing it to get clean. You're doing it to feel good about yourself. You're doing it because, you know, your boss at work is going to say something if you don't look presentable. You have a lot of motives for taking a shower. But I'll bet you most of the time, your motive for taking a shower is not the shower itself. The very act of taking a shower, for most people, is a nuisance. Sometimes it's enjoyable to do. Sometimes it's wonderful when you're tired after a long day to just get in that shower and feel the water over you. Sometimes that's a wonderful thing. At that moment, you're taking a shower for its own sake. And you're enjoying it. That's the point. But when you got something else on your mind, or you don't feel like taking a shower at that moment, then you're in a situation you don't want to be in. And you pretty much are hypocritical about taking a shower. You do it because you have to. And you keep you try to put your mind on something other than the fact that you're taking a shower. In other words, you are ignoring the situation you're in, or you're telling yourself something else about the situation you're in. You're lying your way through it, essentially. You're lying or rationalizing your way through it. Well, I have to take a shower because I have to look presentable, or whatever. A lot of times, what you'll try to do, being a normal human being, you will think about something else. You'll just try to avoid noticing the situation that you're in. And here it's a simple example of taking a shower, but you could replace that example of taking a shower with anything else in life. You're at a party you don't want to go to. You have to stand at the bus stop. Everybody, when they're standing in an elevator together, what are we all doing? We're ignoring the fact that we're in an elevator because we're all crowded, and we're all looking at the numbers. That's hypocrisy right there. But here we're getting to why are we hypocritical. We're trying to get through a situation we don't want to be in. Okay? And the inability is that we find ourselves stuck with, or imagine ourselves stuck with, being in the situation. And we can't get out of it, so we lie our way through it. And we do that all day long. With everything, especially with church. I mean, that's one of the first things I remember about adults in church, is they went because it made them feel like they were important. They were good if they went. Had nothing to do with God, had nothing to do with church. It was all about doing what was expected because it was expected. But there's no pleasure in it, because the thing that you're doing because it's expected is something you have to do. Okay? Now, that thing you have to do is something you don't want to do, is something you feel you're stuck in, is where you have an inability, and you lie your way through it to get through it. The more you do that, the less you're enjoying life, obviously. The less you're enjoying the things that you're actually doing, the more you have to get compensation elsewhere, the more you have to tell yourself that the thing you're doing it for is the thing you're doing to get. And how do I want to put this? The less life is enjoyable in general. Because once you start down doing that with a little thing, you're going to do it for the next thing, and the next thing, it builds a habit. And we all start those habits very early in life. Parents teach their children to lie. They call it good behavior. Children do not learn, oh, this is a good idea because they're not taught the reasons. They're just taught, well, you're bad and you'll get spanked if you don't do this. You're good and you get praised if you do this. That's all they're told. So they're given to, how do you want to call it? They're hooked on their own sin nature early by their parents as a shorthand way of getting your kid to do the right thing when he doesn't understand why it's the right thing. And the parent will argue, well, but he's too young to understand. Maybe, but if you don't tell him why at the beginning, then he's not going to learn that there is one. Instead, what you're telling him is to be a good boy. So then his motive for life is going to be how good he is instead of the intrinsic value of what he does. So this hypocrisy problem integrates early, it integrates deeply, and we never grow out of it. So it becomes our immediate fallback, our defense mechanism, when we're in a situation we don't want to be in, when we have an inability, when we can't do something, can't do the way we want, can't do what we want, can't do it for as long as we want. And we learn to lie as a mechanism of getting through life, which means that we are not asking the question why. We're basically taught very early on not to question because our parents won't explain it to us. And they don't explain it to us because they think we can't understand. Well, okay, fine, maybe we can't. But then what's happening with that lesson is we're also learning that it's not good to ask questions. It's only good to lie and fake your behavior. And so little Johnny learns to sit quite still at the table, hating it the whole time. So he learns to hate that situation. Little Jane learns that she has to sit up straight with her back, you know, in proper society. You never actually sat against the back of the chair. You had to have your back ramrod straight. You never were supposed to actually lean back in the chair or sit with your rear end against the chair and your back against it also. That was considered improper. To this day, I have a hard time sitting back in a chair. And when I do, I always feel like I'm doing the wrong thing. Okay? So this stuff gets inculcated early. So too, hypocrisy. In the name of good behavior. In the name of being a good person. In other words, you're a good person if you're a hypocrite. And you use hypocrisy to get out of a bad situation. Like, you know, you look up at the numbers of the elevator. You don't dare look at the other people in the elevator with you. You don't dare talk to them and say hello. Break the ice. The tension is so thick then, because we're all so cluttered together. Now, this inability to cope with a situation gets taught early on at the problem-solving device. It's not really, it doesn't solve problems, it creates them. The problem-solving device we're taught from cradle forward is to be hypocritical, to lie our way through it, to pretend, to shove off, to shut down any kind of discomfort, any kind of semblance of what's considered bad behavior. And we hate that, because humans aren't made to be dishonest. But we're taught that dishonesty is virtue. So you can understand why there's so much dishonesty in life. You can understand why people like to, you know, anything somebody smiley and nice says to you, you just want to believe it right there and then. Because you're taught that. That is good. Now, one of the biggest areas of hypocrisy that we all live with every day, wars and many, many, many deaths have resulted from it. One of the biggest hypocrisies of all that we all live with and yearn over and sing songs about is the hypocrisy of equality. There's no such thing. In fact, if you really stop to think about it, you don't want there to be such a thing. The whole revolutions have been fought over this. Lie. Hypocritical lie. We're all equal. No, we're not. You're unique. There's no such thing as equality. There's nobody else anywhere like you in time. Ever. God created you individually. You're you. There's not another you. There might be a whole lot of people in life who have some passing similarity to you. In certain respects and on certain days. That's about it. God made you unique on purpose. That means that others are better than you in some ways and worse than you in others. And you're better than some in certain ways and worse in others. Period, over and out. You're individual. There's nobody like you. Same thing for me. Having said that, because we're not equal and can't be, it's just not even possible. Because there's so many of us, or because we're human and we live in a society, the only way to deal with the fact that we're unequal is to create commonalities. This is what gets confused with equality. Commonality is not equality. To have a thing in common, that's not equality. That's something else outside of you that is an access. A common access. Like the door to a building. All kinds of people walk through the door of the same building. Take an office building, big office building. Okay, the people who walk through that door, they're all unequal. But the door, and this is where the confusion goes, the door is equally available to all of them. They can all walk through that door. Salvation is equally available as a door. But the people who believe, no two of them are equal. See, the availability of access, the common availability of access, does not connote that the people are equal. This is where the old sin nature twists everything. The old sin nature basically has to say, well, we're equal by nature, which means nobody, no one person is better than another person. The communists make a big deal of that. The whole communist revolution was founded on that. The French Revolution was founded on that mistake. Actually, it's not a mistake, it's a twisting of the truth. People are not equal by nature. And actually, the revolution was supposed to be fought over unequal access to fairness of law, being able to get a job. If you have the abilities requisite for the job and I have the abilities requisite for the job and our two abilities are equal to each other, then we are each equally able to fill that job, perhaps. Depends on what all the requirements of the job are. Okay? But that still doesn't make us equal. See, a commonality of access is not the same thing as you personally being equal to somebody else. So we all have these are the words in the English, in the Greek too. Common salvation. The Greek word is koine. It means common. Okay, it has a lot of other meanings too, but it essentially means like, and this is how it got invented. Alexander the Great invented a version of Greek that was a mix of the various Greek dialects so that his troops could understand him. And then he passed that Koine Greek onto all the lands that he basically took over. And it was a very, it was a very helpful language. And so people who had some other language as their native tongue, they learned to speak Koine Greek about 300 BC. And it stuck. People liked it. They liked the way, they liked its structure, the things that you could do with it. And the New Testament is largely, but not entirely, is largely written in that kind of Greek, which is written 400 years later. Okay, that same kind of Greek is mostly, but not entirely, in the Old Testament too, because the Old Testament was written around 271 BC. Okay, going by the age of the Greek, in which you can date, because if you have Old English, for example, you can tell how old English is if you know the varying stages of English, change in the language. Well, the same thing is true for Greek or any other language. You can tell really old Chinese from later Chinese. Okay, the Chinese that Sun Tzu wrote is very much older than the Chinese of Mao. Very different, very, very different. And somebody who's used to reading Chinese can tell the difference immediately. Same thing is true for the Greek. Okay, but the people who write and speak that Greek, they aren't equal. A king might be able to speak it, and a pauper might be able to speak it. And the fact that one is a king and one is a pauper tells you something else. Commonalities have to be grouped. And that has nothing to do with equality either. It does have a lot to do with the kind of society that results when people have in common certain tastes, certain beliefs, certain cultures, certain abilities. If you were to walk in, if you were to live in Montecito, for example, Montecito, California, where a lot of actors live, okay, they would be talking actor. That's their profession. They're in the movie business, or they're in the films, or they're in the TV, and they talk shop. Well, if you're not familiar with all that vocabulary, and you happen to be able to even get in, you walk into their Starbucks, and you're going to hear them talking shop, and it might as well be another language to you that you don't understand. So you feel sort of like outside. And you will be. You are not equally conversant with their, as it were, profession, occupation, lifestyle. It's a lifestyle as well as an occupation. Every occupation ends up being a lifestyle, especially in the professions. If you're a doctor, you're a doctor 24/7, not just between 9 and 5. Okay, and then that provokes a whole different set of groupings. People who are, let's say, they have 9 to 5 jobs. That's a whole lifestyle that goes with that. You get up at 6, you're at the office by 8, or maybe by 9. You're supposed to get off at 5, but you usually stay a little later because you want to, you know, make points with the boss. So maybe you leave at 6 and you get home by 8. Dinner's supposed to be at 8. I mean, it depends on the culture. I'm speaking of a very specific culture when I say that. Okay? And there are millions of people just like you who live like that. Well, you all have that in common. So when a movie is made that deals with those kinds of subjects, you all have that in common too. And there are a whole bunch of values that go with that. The mowing of the lawn on Saturdays. In America, for a while at least, it was going to church on Sunday. And that was what people had in common. It still wasn't equal, but it was common. So you got common in the sense of common access. And what are supposed to be the laws of equality really should be called the laws of common access. Everybody should have commonly have access to due process of law. Everybody commonly should have access to, you know, a proper trial. And pretty much all of our country, you know, all the countries around the world have similar laws on these things based on the same idea. It shouldn't matter whether you have money or not that you can get justice. Okay, it does matter in point of fact, because a lot of the stuff that goes on requires money in order for you to defend yourself in court. So the rich guy can get off, whereas the poor guy will go to jail, because the rich guy can afford to keep on appealing the sentence. Okay? But when we're talking about the court of God, well, we all at least hope that it doesn't work like that. And of course the Bible says it doesn't work like that. God is, you know, equal opportunity employer. If you did something wrong, I don't care if you're a king or a pauper, you got trouble. Okay? But, and this is what I'm pointing this audio. It took me forever to get here. But if you are a king, whatever happens to punish you punishes others too. Because we're not equal. If you're a pauper, what punishes you is going to affect fewer people or maybe nobody than other than you. So then the punishment that fits the crime has to take into account who else is going to be hurt by the punishment you get. Not merely you. That's really important when you read God's justice in the Bible to understand that. Psalm 37, he just threw that at me. Where David is saying, don't get upset that the wicked seem to prosper. In other words, if God's going to punish the wicked person the way you think that God should punish them, then people, maybe even you, get hurt more. So then he doesn't punish them, or he doesn't punish them in the way expected, because he's not a hypocrite and he doesn't have to fit in with your ideas or anybody else's ideas about what's expected. What he wants to do is to deal with the truth. And you can say, well, but the truth is that when somebody murders, they ought to get the death penalty. Yeah, maybe. And God would know all the facts, wouldn't he? Do you? Now, I happen to favor the death penalty, so don't mistake me for a liberal. But God knows all the facts. I don't. God knows what that person did or didn't do. So when our justice system acts the way it does, rightly or wrongly, whatever that sentence is, it's acceptable because you know that God knows all the facts, and if the sentence is wrong, he'll make good on it. Right? I mean, if you believe in God, you believe that. So if you yourself are subject to injustice, it's the same thing. God knows all the facts. And whatever bad happens to you that shouldn't have, he's going to make good on it. And whatever bad happens to you that should have happened, maybe it should have even been worse, but it isn't. And you know that it should be worse, but it isn't. Well, God's going to make good on that too. And the final analysis, the biggest thing he makes on it, and this is the killer for me, is that God's justice doesn't just deal with your activity today. It's encompassing all the activity of everybody around you, all the thoughts of yourself and everybody around you, today, tomorrow, the next day, a bazillion years from now. And it takes into account one more thing. Your class. This is a hard thing for me to accept, I'm telling you. Your class. Just like I said a couple of minutes ago. The king doesn't get the same kind of punishment that the pauper does. When David did wrong, what happened? He wanted the census. What did God do? God gave him a choice of three punishments. All of those punishments didn't affect David. They would have all affected other people. Okay? One of those choices was that David would lose his kingdom for a while. And one of the choices was that a whole bunch of people would die. And I forget what the third one was. And what did David say? Let the Lord choose. I'm in your hands. And what did the Lord choose? The Lord didn't choose to dethrone David. Well, you can argue he should have. The Lord chose instead to inflict with a plague some, what was it, 70,000 people or something? It's at the end of 2 Samuel. So David wasn't hurt. That doesn't seem too fair now, does it? Typical atheist is going to point something out like that, not understanding what justice really has to be. Justice has to be eternal. It has to be eternal. You and I do not know a bazillion years from now all the causes, conditions, successions, and relations, but God does, and he determines a certain futurition. He has to approve of reality being reality. And he wants truth to be free. And therefore, free to occur. And he knows what that's going to be. So what's just today in light of the whole stream, the ocean of eternity? You don't know. I don't know. And since, you know, really, he's the one who has to live with it. It ought to go by what is fair to him first. And that's the kicker about this class thing. Think about this real hard because it applies to us, and I actually hate what I've got to say. Okay? I've been arguing with God about this for I don't know how long now. David was a king. You can't punish a king the way you punish a pauper, because when you punish the king, you're punishing the kingdom too. So a lot of times you don't punish the king at all for the sake of the kingdom. Or the way you punish the king can't be done in a, you know, sort of typical human idea, usually involving some kind of bodily harm or economic loss. Can't do that, because then it's going to hurt the kingdom that way. You and I are sons of God. He's a king. We can't be punished in a typical manner that unbelievers can be punished. That's a class difference. We are a ruling class. The worst of us and the best of us. Did you believe in Christ? Answer yes. You cannot be punished the same way as an unbeliever can be punished. There is, obviously, because we have so much in common, but not equal. There will be certain events in your life that will be in common with the unbeliever. But really, that's just superficial. Like David, you can only be punished in certain ways because you're a believer. And those ways have to be very carefully constructed, because you're not only a believer, but you're a believer in the middle of the world, in a certain location, with a whole bunch of people around you who are variantly depending on you, who know you or don't know you, and everything has a ripple effect. And by the way, because you're a believer, you actually have information they need. They don't like it, they don't want to hear it, they won't understand it. But you have that information in you, and it's like your little repository of Christ walking around. I'm newly learning how to do this. I got to get up this morning because I have Bible doctrine in me. That's the value of my life. It's not me. It's the doctrine in me. Okay, but that puts me in a separate class. That puts you in a separate class. You're not like Joe Blow, unbeliever next door. Like it or lump it. Good believer or bad believer, obedient to God or not, in fellowship or not, using 1 John 1:9 or not, growing in Christ or not, it doesn't matter. You're a believer, you're in a different class. And of course, amongst believers, then there are also additional classes. Those who are growing, those who are not, those who are gifted with certain gifts amongst the body, like what Paul was saying in 1 Corinthians 12. Yeah, we all fit together, but we're not all the same body part. You notice that? There are different classes of body parts. There's the foot class, there's the ankle class, there's the finger class, there's the head class, there's the chest class, there's the arm class. And they each are better at what they do than the other body parts. But it all fits together because they're unequal. And therefore they are fitting together by means of their commonality as a class. Now Christ told us this. He said, you're not your own. The king is not his own. David was king of Israel. Whatever David was individually as a person, we got a whole lot of information about that. But that's separate from the fact that he's also king, and yet is part and parcel of the fact that he's David. One of the things my pastor said that always used to just drive me nuts, because I didn't understand it at first, when he was talking about Genesis, okay, going through the exegeting Genesis, he'd always stop and say, Adam was not merely created a man, but a husband. The woman was not merely created as a woman, but as a wife. In other words, the role, the class that you're in, is just as much a part of you individually as anything else about you. And yet it's distinct. And the commonalities come through classes. All the wives get together at the potluck. And the men, that's another class, late 1800s, early 1900s, the men after dinner would go into the smoking room, and ideally if they're at the weekend, they're having their smoking jackets. And the women aren't part of that class. They come together, they separate. Classes come together, they separate. We can all go through the same door of salvation. But we're not equal, we're in classes. And even within the classes, we're not equal. Not everybody's a foot. Now, the thing that's so bizarre about this, as far as I'm concerned, is that merely by learning and living on Bible, your class status changes. What everybody around you gets to do and have is their lifestyle and their problems and their needs and their understanding. That's not for you. You might eat food like they do. You might wash your car on Saturday like they do. But that's a surface similarity. Everything that happens to you is happening for the sake of your spiritual life developing. And if it has any, class similarity on the surface to others of your economic or social class, that's as far as it goes. Skin deep. It's really happening for some other reason. And the goal of your spiritual life and the goal of your growth is to integrate away from the hypocrisy of your class. Because every class is a hypocrisy of itself. And to integrate into the truth of the Word of God, yet at the same time living inside a body along with all the other bodies that are living the same way you do. On the surface. Which seems hypocritical. So on the one hand, you're supposed to be honest, but on the other hand, you're not supposed to wear your Christianity on your sleeve. Yes, you're supposed to learn and live on Bible, but no, you're not supposed to go running around telling everybody how good you are because you're a Christian. Frankly, if you do that, you're not being a good Christian. You're supposed to wait until people ask you questions, not go advertise. Religionists advertise. You got three basic lifestyles. You got pagan. Well, pagan isn't even a good word because pagan implies belief in some false gods. You got, let's just say, non-god. All material, all this life, my mother, my brother, my father, my sister. Horizontal life. Then you got religiosity, which is fake vertical life. That's where paganism comes in, and Christianity is just another brand of it. And then you got the spiritual life, which you don't wear on your sleeve. You're living amongst people who are living horizontal or religious lives. And yet you're supposed to stay quiet. Well, isn't that being hypocritical? And that's the big argument. Let's say you're living in a house and, you know, you want to study Bible, but you're married and your spouse doesn't want to. Do you sneak away? Do you make a big stink out of it? Well, I'm studying Bible and you're not. That's a challenge. I don't have the right answer. You have to talk to God about how you handle it. So that it's not hypocrisy, and at the same time, so that it's not the in-your-face, pushy, religious crowd attitude. It's hard. And that's the point about all this. Hypocrisy is our fallback. Hypocrisy is something we learn from the cradle to deal with a situation we don't want to be in. And as a Christian who wants to know God, you're going to find yourself daily in all kinds of situations that you don't want to be in. What do? And that's what a lot of the Bible stories tell you. Abraham was stuck in a situation with his parents he didn't want to be in. At first, you know, his father, Terah, seemed to have, I guess, been positive to God, but that didn't last long. And then Abraham's told to leave his own dad. How do you handle that? Okay, and then you got Jacob. And before him, you had Isaac. They were all put in situations they didn't want to be in. David? That's why he was out with the sheep. His family couldn't stand him. Why? Probably because he wanted Bible. Think about those stories now that you think you know so well, and that I think I know so well. We don't know those stories at all. Think about it from the standpoint of the natural tendency of all of us, inbred, to smile and fake it. Versus when you want to know God, and you're not supposed to smile and fake it that you don't want to know God. But at the same time, you're not supposed to act like the religious crowd who thinks, you know, pats themselves on the back as, oh, I love God, I love God, I'm being holy, I'm being devout, I'm doing all these good things for Jesus. You don't want to be part of them either. And yet, what can you say? What do you not say? Now, in the next increment, I'm going to go back to the whole hypocrisy thing. But bear in mind that this is what's going on underneath. And most importantly, bear in mind that you're not even in the same class the minute you believe in Christ. You're in a royal class the minute you believe in Christ. So you don't get whatever's happening to everybody around you. You're not in their world. I mean, physically you are in their world, but it's you might as well be dead. Okay, then how do you live? Because the next increments are going to sound real, what do you want to call it? Judgmental, condemnatory, and should be. But at the same time, this is the underlying conflict that we're all going through. Peace out.